channel. Today I'm going to be reading a creepypasta called Hands. This creepypasta was suggested by Artemis Arrow. Artemis Arrow, thank you very much for the suggestion. I appreciate it greatly. And for anybody watching the video, make sure to check out Artemis Arrow's YouTube channel, where you'll be able to find a ton of different games, a ton of different Let's Plays, and an overall pretty interesting channel. Definitely check it out. I'm going to be putting a link to Artemis Arrow's channel in my description, so you could check out the channel for yourself. Again, thank you, Artemis Arrow, for the suggestion. I appreciate it greatly. And for anybody else, if you have any suggestions, let me know in the comments down below. I will give you a shout out in the next video. So, without any further ado, let's get right into the story. The worst thing I've ever done in my life happened about 12 years ago when I was a 16-year-old kid living in Cleveland, Ohio. It was the early fall when the leaves were just starting to turn orange and the temperatures were starting to fall, hitting at the freezing chill that was only a few months away. School had just started, but it had been going on for about a month now. So all the excitement of going back and reuniting with old friends had been replaced by the realization that we were all captives in a place that only wanted to load work upon us. Understandably, me and my friends were all eager to do anything that might remind us of the worry-free, responsible-free days of summer. Early that year, about the same time the last school year had let out, one of my friends from work, by the way, he worked at like McDonald's, which some people think it's lame, but I always had a great time there. Anyway, he taught me a technique to make yourself pass out with the help of an assistant. It worked something like this. One person would rapidly take 10 deep, heavy breaths, and on the 10th breath, they would squeeze their eyes shut and hold their breath as tightly as possible, and they would cross their wrists over their heart. The assistant would then give the person a huge bear hug from behind and squeeze the person's wrist into their breastbone. Within seconds, the person holding their breath would lose consciousness. The assistant was then in a perfect position to make sure you didn't totally collapse and crack your skull against the sidewalk. The effects only lasted for like about a second or two, but it wasn't like you were putting yourselves in a coma or anything, but it felt like you had been out for hours. When you regained consciousness, the disoriented feeling and not knowing why the hell you were there felt amazing. Now, I know some people are like, what the fuck are you retards doing? And yeah, I know, we were probably killing about a million brain cells each time we were knocking ourselves out. And I think probably my memory has suffered because of it. But to be a bored as hell 16-year-old, I thought it was hella cool. All the effects of getting your lights punched out, and with none of the pain of getting hit in the face, I tell you to try it yourself, but after what happened, I would never recommend it to anyone. One interesting side effect of doing this, which was really most of the reason we did it, was that while you were out, you'll have extremely lucid, vivid dreams, which you could always recall upon awaking. After all, you were only asleep for like 2 seconds. We were good kids and would never try drugs. So to us, this was like a poor man's LSD. These visions, in some way, were usually related to what you were looking at right before you passed out. For example, once I dreamed that I was climbing a mountain, well, way up in the Himalayas or something, but there was a handrail there. Who the hell puts handrails at 20,000 feet up? When I regained consciousness and remembered where I was, I realized I had been looking at the staircase at the corner of my girlfriend's living room. Another time, I had a vision of Fred Flintstone smiling and holding out his hand in front of a mural of the DARE logo. The Their logo stands for Drug Abuse Resistance Education, which is a program cops teach in public schools. You've probably seen it on a bumper sticker. When I woke up and saw that my friend Bert had been standing in front of me right before I slipped into dreamland, and that his shirt had a Dare logo on it. Where Fred Flintstone came from, I have no idea. The visions were always mundane things like these. Anyways, until that one day. Like I said, the school had been going on for about a month, and we were already sick of it. We had been hanging out one Saturday in the field, which was really an easement for the electric company to run their high voltage lines. A few of us were sitting on the metal beams at the bottom of one of the towers. My friend Mike was climbing up to the second tier of beams so he could jump the 8 or 10 feet to the ground. I thought it was stupid, but hey, I'm the guy who thought it was cool to induce unconsciousness by starving the brain of oxygen. It was a warm day for October, but the light gray of the sky was slowly getting darker. And in Cleveland, in October, that probably meant that before long, the temperature would soon drop from a comfortable 70 to 50 in a course of a minute. And if we were really unlucky, an ice cold rain would start to fall. The air was already damp and heavy, and we could hear the buzzing of high tension wires above us. I sure as hell didn't want to spend the last few moments of a pleasant Saturday afternoon watching this dumbass climb partway up the high tension tower, jump down, and complain about how, oh, that one killed his feet, only to climb up and do the same stupid thing again. So I suggested, hey, let's make ourselves pass out, I said. By that time, it wasn't as much fun as it had been in the early summer when we first discovered it, but it was hell of a lot better than what we were doing. Vince was up for it, so was Richard, but Mike, the guy that was jumping off the tower, said, what the fuck are you talking about? Holy crap, you haven't been knocked out before? Vince asked. No, was the response. Mike had been at his mom's house all summer, so he hadn't been in on the fun when we had been doing it. Dude, you gotta try this. Watch, we'll show you. Vince and I got off the tower, stood in the grass at the center, and I did the customary 10 deep breaths. I squeezed my eyes shut and held my breath so hard that if they had been they hadn't been shut, they'd probably pop out of my head. Then I felt my friend clamp down on my arms in front of my chest. And suddenly, as if there was nothing more natural in the world, there was a giant lobster climbing around a lobster cage. And I was under the ocean with seaweed growing from the sandy bottoms under my feet. The next thing I remember, I was awakened and Vince and Richard were asking me, dude, what did you see? What'd you dream? The back of my head was killing me. Fuck, did you let me fall? I wasn't really that heavy, but Vince was pretty weak. He just stood there looking guilty, and Richard told me he had. What did you see? He asked. I rubbed my head and said it was a lobster pinching Vince's head off with its claws. I turned to Mike, watching for the L-shaped beams above, and said, see, it's fucking awesome. Whatever, I don't trust any of you enough to do that shit to me. Come on, man. You gotta try it. It's no more dangerous than what we've been doing now. I promise, I won't let you fall like this bitch did. He squinted, in the way people do when they're trying to decide if what they're thinking of doing is worth the risk or trouble. He jumped down one last time, got up and said, fine, once. If only he would have thought a little longer or just flatly refused. He repeated the 10 deep breaths with me as an assistant to make sure he didn't fall. He held his breath and I helped him slip into that other place. It's something I regret ever since. When I think back on all the things I wish I had done differently in my teenage years, girls I should have tried for, classes I should have worked harder in, and all the things I shouldn't have done, putting him in that bear hug and squeezing him into an unconscious state is something I most regret. I felt the dead weight shift from his feet onto my chest, and he was a pretty big guy, but I made sure to let him down easy and not knock his head against the hard packet earth. Just as I laid him on the ground, he came back. He woke up screaming, "Holy fuck! Holy fuck, get away!" he screamed, as he leaped to his feet and flailed his arms around his head. We all jumped back, afraid of being hit in his frenzy, but more afraid, so scared we almost shit our pants of what we were seeing. After about 5 seconds, which is about twice the time it normally took a person to realize where they were at and remember what they were doing, he slowed down. He said, "Shit. Shit, holy shit." He was breathing heavily, gasping deep breaths, and hunched over at the corner of the tower. It was a wonder that in his maddened state, he didn't run right into the supports and knock himself out for real. But he just stood there, bent over at the waist. Then he fell to his knees. With his back turned to us, he started rocking and squeezing his hands and muttering to himself. "Holy mother of fuck," said Vince. "What the hell did you see?" But Mike didn't answer. We approached him slowly, and as we drew near, we could hear him quietly sobbing. In our macho world, that was normally a crime punishable by death. But at this time, we didn't say a word. I reached out a hand to his shoulder, but as soon as I touched him, a touch so tentative and light that he shouldn't have even been able to feel it, he shrieked and jumped away, clinging his back into the corner of the tower. He pressed it up hard against it, staring at us with a look of terror in his eyes, so real you'd think we were demons from the pit of hell. If ever in those few moments I thought that he was putting on or pretending just to fuck with us, that look put all my doubts to rest. That and what happened afterwards, of course. None of us said anything, but after about 10 minutes, Mike had calmed down enough that Richard was able to coax him to his feet and lead him back to his house. As I had suspected, the temperature had fallen like crazy in just a few minutes, and just as I'd figured it would, the freezing cold drizzled started to fall. I told Vince I was just gonna go home and I'd see him tomorrow. We always spent the evening and rainy days playing Mortal Kombat on our SNES, but he didn't object. I think he probably wanted some time alone to reflect on the horrible things we had done to our friend, just like I did. The next day, I went to see how Mike was doing, but he and his dad were gone the whole day. I asked him later where he went, but he wouldn't tell me. I think it must have been to a psychiatrist, because by Tuesday, the next time I saw him, he seemed to be better, if a little zoned out. I figure he probably got some drugs to calm his nerves, but that's just a guess. I never really found out. Over the next few days, the four of us hung out, and while Mike was quiet, he didn't say anything about what happened. We just talked about stupid, unimportant stuff. Girls we liked, classes at school that we hated. I wish we had said something to him now, though I don't know if it really would have helped. We had no idea what we were facing, and to this day, I still have no clue. But we avoided the subject of what had happened that Saturday, and the practice of passing out in general. It was like the plague. It wasn't until the following Saturday that he said anything related to what happened to him. We were walking down the quiet street of our neighborhood towards the wooden footbridge that crosses the creek that runs between the houses, separating the development into two halves. I was going on about this hot girl and he stared at the ground, walking with his hands in his pockets. Suddenly, out of nowhere, and right in the middle of one of my sentences, he says, "I won't be around much for long." "Huh?" I replied. "They'll be coming again tonight, and I don't think I'll be able to keep them out this time." Hey, what are you talking about? Who's coming?" "The hands. The voice," he said. At this point, I was like, holy shit. I could feel my breathing get quick and shallow and I felt my face and hands get hot to hear him talk. So matter of fact, about something horrible that I couldn't even imagine, but I'll never forget that conversation. So etched into my mind like a stone tablet in the Ten Commandments. I stammered it a few times, then said stupidly, "What hands?" At night, I look at the tree outside my window. Then it goes black, and the hands, dozens, hundreds of them, push in against the glass. "What do you do?" I replied. "I push back all night, but I'm tired. I can't keep them out anymore." And the voices say I have to let them in. Little kid voices and little kid hands. He lowered his voice to a whisper, but I could hear him. And what he said next, that he was struggling to keep panic at bay. "Sometimes I see their faces," he said in a trembling voice. We had come to the walkway up to his house. He stopped it and finally lifted his face to me. "Tell Vince he can't have my Super Nintendo. He doesn't have one, and his mom sure as hell won't buy him one. Richard can have my CDs. I know you guys don't like rap, but he does." I started to say something, but he turned and walked up to his house. He went inside and closed the door. How I wish I would have went up and knocked, told him I would have stayed the night, but we were 16 and at that age, guys don't do that anymore. So I just went home. I didn't even answer the door for Vince when he came over later. When I went to bed, I didn't sleep well and I was constantly listening to every creak and groan that the house made, listening for the voice of a multitude of children. I normally slept with the curtains open, but tonight I had them closed. The next day, we learned that someone had broken into Mike's house. A police car was there in the driveway, and I was about to shit a brick when I saw it. Later, my worst fears were confirmed, and I learned that it was Mike's bedroom window that had been broken into. He was missing, was all they told us. The cops asked all three of us a ton of questions, and people from the Center of Missing and Exploited Children came and asked us more. I'm sure I looked as guilty as shit, but when I said I didn't know what happened, it was, after all, half true. They were looking for some pervert that had abducted Mike. So no matter how hard they grilled me, they couldn't get any information relating to that. Of course, so finally they gave up. He was on milk cartons and missing children TV shows. But to this day, he is still an unsolved case. After it was all over, I went to the library to research what the fuck had happened. The because in those days, while the internet was a research tool, it was only for rocket scientists and people who could afford $5,000 computers. The closest thing that I think is related is something I only discovered later in my junior class of world history. Apparently, Egyptian priests used to seal themselves in coffins for just long enough of a time to almost die. They would then be resurrected so they could relate the things they saw in the netherworld while dead to the other priest. I could only figure that perhaps the electricity in the air or the weather made Mike go under deeper than we ever had and given him an experience something like the Egyptian priest had. But Vince knocked me out too, in almost the same spot where Mike was standing when I did it to him. Could he have just been more receptive to the call of the other place? Or had knocking my head on the ground somehow jolted me free of their hold? I don't know. And I don't think I ever will. But sometimes, it still makes me shiver.